At any rate, on top of these chords, then Harold started the thing off with an octave jump. Somewhere, okay? And Yip had no idea what to do with that octave jump. Incidentally, Harold did this in Paper Moon, too. If you remember, let's see, how does that start?
It's only a paper moon sailing over a cardboard sea. But it wouldn't be make-believe if you believed in me.
Yeah, Harold was a great composer. So Yip wrestled with it for about 3 weeks. And finally he came up with the word. You see, this is what a lyricist is. The word to hit the storyline, the character, the music. It's an incredible thing. Somewhere. All right? And then when you put it in an octave, you get somewhere. Okay? And you jump up, and you're ready for take that journey. All right? Where? Over the rainbow. Okay? And then you're off. It's not a love song. It's a story of a little girl that wants to get out. She's in trouble and she wants to get somewhere. Well, the rainbow was the only color that she'd see in Kansas. She wants to get over the rainbow. But then Yip put in something which makes it a Yip song. He said, "And the dreams you dare to dream really do come true," you see. And that word dare lands on the note, and it's a perfect thing, and it's been generating courage for people for years afterwards, you know.
Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue, and the dreams that you dare to dream.
That's the way that the whole score came.
Was it a hit right away?
No, it wasn't. This was supposed to be an answer, MGM's answer to Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And of about 10 major critics at that time, when Wizard of Oz came out, I would say only two liked the show. The other eight said it was corny, that it was heavy, that Judy Garland was no good, and so forth. So, oh yeah, you could read again in the book Who Put the Rainbow in the Wizard of Oz by Harold Meyerson and Ernie Harburg. And but it persisted, you know. And then in 1956, when television first started saturating the nation.
More than 20 years later.
More than 20 years later. I don't think they even had their money back from the show, see. MGM sold the film rights to CBS, who then put it on. And it hit the top of the, it broke out every single record there was, and it's been playing every year since then. And of course, it went around the world, and it's become a major art work, which is, I must say, an American artwork, because the story, the plot with the three characters, the brain, the heart, the courage, and finding a home, is a universal story for everybody. And that's an American kind of story, all right? And Yip and Harold put these things into song.
Who did the Munchkins represent?
We represent the Lollipop Guild, the Lollipop Guild, the Lollipop Guild, and in the name of the Lollipop Guild.
Oh, in the, you mean political thing? I think they represented the little people, you know, the people, and that's the way they were came on in the book. You see, the book, if you're a purist, you wouldn't like the film. It's just like anything else. There are societies of people who meet and discuss the books. Okay, there's even a society for the Winkies, which are the guards around the Wicked Witch's, its castle. There really is. They meet once a year, and they're serious. And they don't like the picture because it didn't follow the book. See, because Yip and the writers changed it as Hollywood will.
Was the book a little bit more favorable to the Winkies?
No. Well, yes. The Winkies were good people, and they were played up there. If you go back and read the book, you will see that they were a lovely, decent kind of people. Yes. That was one thing. I guess it wasn't PC there, you know. But nevertheless, when you read a good novel and you see the film, there's hardly any relationship between the two. All these lines from a film have entered the American language in a way that people don't even know where they came from, you know. Toto, looks like we're not in Kansas anymore. Or, come out, come out, wherever you are, which in the 70s started taking on when the gay movement started. This line started meaning different things, you see.
Come out, come out, wherever you are, and meet the young lady who fell from a star.
So the songs keep growing with the times people interpret them, you know?
How did Yip feel in late 1950s when it was a hit, when people started hearing it all over the world?
Well, I think they were quite surprised, along with the film moguls, you know, and the fact that it, years later, he and Harold both said that they did not know what depth and strength that that song Over the Rainbow had. And also one other one, the song Ding Dong the Witch is Dead is a universal liberation of freedom, a cry for freedom, you know, which isn't seen like that, but it one time when some tyrannical owner of an airlines company stepped down, all the employees started singing Ding Dong the Witch is Dead. See, so people use these words, and during the war, World War II, We're Off to See the Wizard was sung by troops marching, you know. So, but nobody knows that Yip wrote the words. It's, now, Harold wrote the music, and the songs were Yip and Harold. That's right.
Because of the wonderful things he does, we're off to see the wizard.
This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. If you'd like a copy of today's program, you can go to our website at democracynow.org. We'll be back in a minute.
Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once I built a tower to the sun, brick and rivet and lime. Once I built a tower, brother, can you spare a dime?
This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the largest public media collaboration in the country, broadcasting on over 300 community radio stations, Pacifica stations, NPR stations, public access TV stations, on PBS stations, and on both satellite networks, Free Speech TV and Link TV on Dish Network, and on Link TV on DirecTV. I'm Amy Goodman as we continue our tour through the life of lyricist Yip Harburg with his son, Ernie Harburg.
We're walking through the gallery here at the Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts, which has the Necessity of Rainbows, which dedicated to the works of Yip Harburg, the lyricist. And we're now looking at the various exhibitions. And while we're looking for Finian's Rainbow, I want to tell you that in 1944, Yip conceived and co-wrote the script and put on a show called Bloomer Girl, which was a way ahead of its time, because Bloomer Girl was Dolly Bloomer, who was an actual suffragette in 1860, who stood up and invented pants.